ourselves is why we're privileged. We get to hear the message of the week. If I subtract everyone else, and the other way we can do it, we go personally, or
we help send people that God has called to go there. A privilege. So this morning I've asked the missionary to come and teach because I like hearing the Word of God being taught about missions. And I know you do too. And others will come in, they can come in and fill in. And brother, if you would please come forward. I appreciate you coming and being with us today. God bless you, my brother.
Thank you, Pastor and Church. Thank you for having us out and for the privilege it is to be here. It's a real treat to be here and meet you folks and teach about the Word on missions and present a little bit about what we're trying to do in Germany. So I am Russ McCrocklin, and my wife Bianca is sitting here with our oldest daughter Madeline and youngest daughter Amelia. And we are on deputation or pre-filled ministry trying to get to Germany for our first term. We are at about 88% support, which we're really excited about that. We just had a huge answer to prayer yesterday come through because we were trying to raise our outfit and passage money. That's all the money for shipping and airfare and all kinds of expenses like language school. And we were at about 50%, and we had one of our supporters give us a huge amount of money that gave. Really, 50% of that came in yesterday all at once. So I was overwhelmed with praise for that. So we're basically, at 100% on our outfit and passage right now. We have the money we need to actually go to Germany, get the airline tickets, do the shipping and all. And so we just need our regular monthly support, about 12%, to come in. And Lord willing, that will in the next couple of months, because we really want to be going in August. The end of August is kind of our target date to get on a plane, go to Germany for our first term, and begin language school and working with the German people, as well as anyone else that we encounter there, which right now could be Ukrainians. Lots of Ukrainians coming into the town we're working in. There is a church plant that started in the town of Neumarkt, which is about 30 minutes south of Nuremberg, an hour and a half north of Munich. That's in the state of Bavaria. You can see our table here. We have the Bavarian flag on the left. There's 16 states in Germany. And so we're trying to go to Bavaria, about the middle of Bavaria, somewhere like that. It's in the southeast of Germany. And it is typical German when you think about Lederhosen and Oktoberfest and all that. That's Bavaria, yeah. So very exciting. And there's a church plant there with another missionary, Mark Boyd, and he has got that going. He's got a good core group. He's excited. He's got some men now that he's training for leadership and to get more involved in the church. Germany, I think, typically is a very maternal society. So the fathers and the dads will tend to stay home, and the wives will come to church and do all the spiritual labor. And that is probably to be understood because after World War II, there were no men. The women had to rebuild the country. So, but overcoming that barrier now in the church is one of the main obstacles that missionaries in Germany face, trying to train German men to take over leadership, pastoral roles, and things like that. So they do have an institute there, and we are training some of the men in good theology, good conservative theology in the Bible, to take over these churches that we're planting. But I'll talk more about that later on in the service, and maybe if you have some questions, see me at my table afterwards. I'll be happy to talk more about it. We love all things German. Get a prayer card at our table. Pray for us, you know, and those are some things you could pray for. We could make it in August. Now, if we don't, that's okay. We'll just go whenever we can, but we'd really like to make it by August. We got reasons for that I could elaborate on later. And if you want, you can sign up for our prayer letter. We send out a prayer letter about every 2 months. About where we're at, what we're doing, how things are going. So, but if you have your Bible, you can turn to Romans chapter 1 in your Bible. And I have a series of messages, but I'm trying to kind of overview them right now and break them down for you. And just we're just going to look through Romans real quick. Because Romans, in my opinion, and I think, honestly, is a very missions-oriented book, isn't it? I mean, if you start thinking about some verses that come to mind with Romans, what's coming to mind? Well, the Romans Road might be the first thing that comes to mind. And so right away, one of the most condensed versions of Romans, the most condensed, summarized thing you can say about it is the gospel. I mean, you're going Romans 3:23, 5:8, 6:23, and 10:13. That might be like the quickest thing I could give you about it. And what is it? Well, it's the Romans Road. It's leading you straight to heaven. And that's beautiful, wonderful. And I think that is by design. Paul, he lived the gospel. It just oozed out of him, I think, is definitely what you get off of him when you read anything he wrote. And so he wrote this book, this letter, Romans to the Roman church, and the best summary we have of it is the gospel. But think for a minute with me, and it is a very comprehensive presentation of the gospel. In fact, it's the most comprehensive I think we have in the entire Bible. It's the closest thing we have to just a doctrinal teaching on a doctrine. Let me just go through the whole of salvation from you're a sinner, to justification, to sanctification, and issues you have in the Christian life, to is God going to save Israel now? What about Israel? Are they getting saved? And he answers that question in Romans 11:26. He says, yes, they will be. God has not forgotten about them. And then he goes into even more nitty-gritty stuff about being in the church and getting along, the Jews and Gentiles and us different cultures in the gospel. And so, you know, think for me a minute, though, who is Paul writing to with Romans? Who are the Romans, though? Well, they're Christians. They're believers, the Roman church. They have their church already going. They presumably have elders, pastors, deacons. They have quite a large bit of people, I think, to where they met in several house churches. It was quite a large church. It was in the premier Gentile city of the world at that time. I guess you could say the Roman church was like a church in Manhattan, you know, and lots of people were going, and they had an impact. Their witness was going out in the world. People knew about this church in Rome. They knew what was going on, like people know what's going on in New York City a lot of times. Okay, but look at the intro and conclusion to Romans. That's what I'm focusing on right now, because we know what the body of the letter says, don't we? And the body of the letter starts in about 1:16, chapter 1, verse 16. That's where he gives the theme of the letter. I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. You know, it is the power of God unto salvation to the Jew and the Gentile. And then he begins to elaborate on what that gospel is all the way until Romans chapter 15, verse 13. He really lays out what do you mean by the gospel, Paul? Well, he'll tell you. He tells you in great detail. But if you were going to lay out the gospel so clearly, would you do that to a church? Would you do that to believers? Why would I come in here and tell you guys about the gospel? Don't you know it? And I think the answer is, yeah, we do. Now, obviously, we don't know it to the extent that Paul knows it, right? Or knew it. I don't think the Romans would have known it to the extent that Paul knew it. And so he's undoubtedly filling in gaps in their knowledge. And which one of us would dare to say, I know all about Romans. I can interpret it perfectly. And I will tell you every nuance in there. Now, there may be some of us that have spent a lifetime studying it and have a pretty good handle on it. And I would say, good. Very good. But most of us would say, yeah, you know, I'm still working on chapter 7. I am little, okay, there's some things in chapter 8. I'm like, And definitely 9 through 11, you know. You're like, yeah, there's a lot in there. That's deep. Okay, so the Romans would have undoubtedly gotten this letter and said, wow, this is deep. Let's look at this some more. But it's good. So why then, again, is he sending this to them? Why? Well, look at the intro and conclusion. I'm just going to read through it, and we'll try to answer that question. As we look at the introduction and conclusion to the letter, that's where you can start to see some of the nuts and bolts, some of the brass tacks of what Paul's doing with his life, his ministry, why he's even writing the Romans, what he's trying to plan on doing, what he's been doing. And so those become kind of like bookends around the central message of the gospel that he's eating and breathing and living in his life, right? So look at chapter 1, verse 1. It says, Paul, a servant of Jesus Christ, called to be an apostle, separated into the gospel of God. There you have the gospel right away. He's focused on that. And he says, which he had promised before by his prophets in the Holy Scriptures concerning his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, which was made of the seed of David according to the flesh, and declared to be the Son of God with power according to the Spirit of holiness by the resurrection from the dead. That's the gospel right there. Very briefly, it kind of echoes a little bit about what he says in 1 Corinthians 15, 3 through 4, the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus. And then he says, verse 5, by whom we have received grace and apostleship for obedience to the faith among all nations for his name, among whom ye all are ye also the called of Jesus Christ. Okay, right away, he sets this tone up of missions. The gospel is to go out among all nations. From the get-go, he's focused not just on the gospel, but on getting the gospel to the nations. And so that's why I like to call Romans a missionary letter hidden in plain sight. So perhaps you get some missionary letters from some missionaries you know, support, and pray for, and they report back a little bit about what they're doing, what's happened, how God has blessed them or blessed their ministry or what their plans are for the next step. And I think that's what this is. This is a first century letter from a missionary telling a church about how God has blessed his ministry, what he's about, and what he wants to do in the future. And we miss that sometimes because we just blow over the intro and conclusion and go, those aren't very important. Let's get to the meat of the letter, which is true, chapter 1, verse 16. That's where you really start to get into the meat. And then he starts to describe the nature of God and how he is not going to let people off for their sins because their sins are gross and huge in his face. And we are very unholy. And God is very holy. And he talks about that in chapter 1 and 2 and then 3. And then he starts to talk about the remedy for that. Christ came and we can have his righteousness imputed to our account like Abraham just by believing. But again, why is he saying that? Well, ultimately, this gospel he's describing in chapter 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, he wants it to go to the nations. And he's been busy about doing that. Okay, verse 7, to all that be in Rome, beloved of God, called to be saints, he's recognizing their believers, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. First, I thank my God through Jesus Christ for you all, that your faith is spoken of throughout the whole world. He's heard about them. Hey, that's missions right there. There's this church in Rome, and they are obviously busy about getting the gospel out to Rome, and perhaps further than that, because somehow their message has gone out to the whole world. People have heard about them and what they're doing in Rome. Verse 9, for God is my witness, whom I serve with my spirit in the gospel of his Son, that without ceasing I make mention of you always in my prayers. Yes, Paul is praying for the Romans. The missionary is praying for this church. That's fascinating, isn't it? Did you ever stop to think that perhaps, I can't speak, if you have missionaries you pray for, that they pray for you? Now, I do. I pray for my supporting churches. I actually pray for all the churches I visit. You guys will go on my prayer list after this, and you will be added to it, and you will get in the rotation. There's a lot, so I can't pray for you every day, not even every week. But at some point in the year, in the month, I will pray for this church by name. And I'm not saying that because, you know, to toot my own horn. I'm just saying missions is reciprocal. It's always reciprocal. You pray for your missionaries, but never take for granted they may be praying for you. They're concerned about you and what's going on in your church. I'm concerned about what's going on in the churches that support me. And others that don't support me, but maybe they support me by prayer, and I know them, I'm familiar with them. Okay, so I'm taking some of my cues, some of my things that I want to do from Paul. And that's kind of what I want you guys to do as well. Look at one of the greatest missionaries here, first century, laying out this pattern, setting this precedent. What did he do that we can pick up on and say, yeah, this is good. We need to do this. All right, so verse 10, making request. This is what he's praying about. If by any means, now at length, I might have a prosperous journey by the will of God to come unto you. For I long to see you, that I may impart unto you some spiritual gift, to the end ye may be established. That is, that I may be comforted together with you by the mutual faith, both of you and me. Very reciprocal, isn't it? He's like, what's he praying about? That I want to come see you guys, fellowship with you, impart some spiritual gift, some spiritual nugget to you, encourage you in the faith, and you guys can comfort me. Rome was going to comfort Paul. They were going to do something that would strengthen his faith. And he's confident of that, and I always am. I that's why I like going to churches. We travel around. We go to churches, and I always pray, Lord, help me to edify your people. Give something for your people that would edify them, but I kind of know already, hey, they're going to do something for me. They're going to strengthen me. They're going to show me just the fact that there are believers here worshiping on Sunday morning is already edifying to me. It is a privilege to see this, to say, hey, I know of some believers here in New Jersey that meet, and they are worshiping Jesus Christ. And I can pray for them, and it's amazing. Just this, I'm just telling you a little bit about my heart and the reciprocity of this. Verse 13, now I would not have you ignorant, brethren, that oftentimes I purposed to come unto you, but was let hitherto, that I might have some fruit among you also, even as among the other Gentiles. So he's kind of saying, you know, I've been thinking about coming to Rome for a while, but I just keep getting hindered for different reasons. And he said, I really want to have a ministry there. I want to go out with you guys and win some people to Christ in Rome, like they've been doing the whole time. He's like wanting to join in on that. And I can totally get that. Verse 14, I am debtor both to the Greeks and to the barbarians, both to the wise and to the unwise. That word, at verse 15, so as much as in me is, I am ready to preach the gospel to you that are at Rome also. Who's he talking about? Again, these believers already know the gospel, don't they? Again, he's going to teach them and preach them a very full, comprehensive gospel. And that's what he's laying out in Romans. He's about to lay that out. What does he mean? Well, he's going to talk about original sin. He's going to talk about justification at death. He's going to talk about sanctification and how to work out your salvation with fear and trembling. He's going to go through that in Romans 6, 7, and 8. And then he's going to talk about election, a very difficult topic, right? It's going to be a very difficult thing. He's laying that out in 9 through 11. He's going to talk about, what about Israel? What's going on with Israel? Then he's going to talk about their relationship with the Jews. How do we as Gentiles get along with them? Those are some things he's laid out already ahead of time in the letter that I'm sure he's going to get into in person when he visits. But look at what he says in verse 14. I am debtor both to the Greeks and to the barbarians. That right there is very missiological. That word Greek, that's kind of a sophisticated Gentile. Okay? That's someone who speaks Greek and is eloquent and is educated, and you might think about some people in Manhattan or something, you know, wow, they're pretty up there, and they're eloquent and wise. And then he says, but I'm going to preach to them as well as the barbarians. Who's the barbarians? Now, that's me. How do I know that? Well, listen to the way I talk, you know. I'm from Tennessee, so what you're hearing is a Southern-type slang. And maybe Northerners can go, yeah, you know, I'm not understanding everything you're saying. Or, wow, that's a different kind of way of speaking English. And I get that. And that is what the Greeks would do to people who couldn't speak Greek. Maybe they were speaking another language, some tribal language, okay? They really didn't know Greek that well, or they spoke Greek with a heavy accent. And you know what the Greeks people would do then? They called them barbarians. You know, that's derogatory. It's racist. That's a racist term is what it is. It comes from the idea that I don't get their language. I don't even know what they're speaking. It's just some weird, you know, indigenous language. And to the Greeks, it sounded like bar, 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 bar. That's what they were hearing. So you hear somebody speaking, you don't know their language, you just blah, 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 blah. And you can maybe look down on that and think they're inferior to you because you don't understand their language. It's just some, I don't know what they're talking about. Why don't they just learn English? And we can have that attitude, right? About minorities, about immigrants, about other cultures and people. You could go to Germany and go, why don't they just learn English? I don't get what they're saying. It's so harsh. It sounds like they're angry all the time when they're talking, you know? But to the German, it's perfectly normal. We're not angry. I'm just, you know, I really need my consonants. I got to bust out my consonants, and it sounds angry to an English speaker. Okay, so the Greeks were definitely ethnocentric. They had looked down on other people in the Roman Empire and outside the Roman Empire that would come in maybe with their languages. And they just called them, that's where that name comes from. Paul says, I don't care where you come from and what you talk like, who you are. He said, I want to preach the gospel to you. Why? Because that's the most loving thing you can do. That's the least ethnocentric thing you can do. Is preach the gospel to someone, to tell them the remedy for their number one problem. What is your number one? It's like, I don't really know where you come from. I don't know a lot about your background and your language, but I do know what your number one problem is because it's the number one problem of all mankind. We have sin. A sin problem that separates us from our Creator and our relationship with Him that was damaged in the Garden of Eden. And so he's like, I just want to be able to communicate them in any way I can and preach to them the gospel. So then he says, verse 15, so as much as in me is, I am ready to preach the gospel to you that are at Rome also. And then verse 16, I think what's happening here, I'm not sure about this. This is my theory about Romans and the way he started this out. And he's starting to lay out, this is what I want to do. This is my plans for future ministry. You know, he's like, I'm going to come to Rome. I'm going to preach the gospel, reap a harvest. And I'm ready for this. And as soon as he mentions the word gospel here, it just triggers in his mind, what is the gospel? And he begins to just, it just begins to spill out of him. Verse 16, for I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. What is it? It is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. For therein is the righteousness of God revealed from faith to faith, as it is written, the just shall live by faith. Huge text on the gospel there. What is it? It's the righteousness of God given to us by faith. And so, all mankind can be justified in the sight of God by simply believing in Christ, not by works of righteousness, which we have done, right? And then he begins to lay that out. What does all that mean? And I think, I don't know, you know, we don't know how fast he wrote this letter, but I suspect when he got to this verse, this just started flowing out of him. Because he was so gospel saturated at this point in his life, that he probably didn't even put this pen down and just was like, oh, it's this, and it's this, and it's this, and this is what I've been teaching, and this, and this, and he's like flipping, you know, he's going through the scroll. Like, and he gets all the way, turn to chapter 15. He gets to chapter 15, verse 13, and really brings it to a close. Another big verse in Romans. Chapter 15, verse 13, now the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing that ye may abound in hope through the power of the Holy Ghost. Like, sum it up, the gospel. If you pay attention to everything he said and you implement that in your life, you'll have hope, you'll be filled with joy and peace in believing, you'll abound in hope, he says it again, and why? Because of the power of the Holy Ghost living in you. Think about Romans chapter 8 and all he said there in Romans chapter 8. Okay, so then perhaps here, I don't know, you know, I'm just thinking about this. He gets to verse 14, this part of the letter, and he's like, what was I writing about? What was I writing this letter for? Oh, yeah, right. I want to go to Rome and do this ministry among them. That's right. And he comes back to that thought, okay, kind of, what did I need to tell them about? Yeah, oh, okay, yeah. After really writing virtually the longest letter he's ever written to a church, Romans, he comes to the point where he's like, yeah, I need to get back to why I want to get to Rome, what I'm trying to do. So he says in verse 14, and I myself also am persuaded of you, my brethren, that ye also are full of goodness, filled with all knowledge, able also to admonish one another. Notice how flowery that language is. See, Paul did not start the Roman church. He is not their spiritual father. And they have perhaps started by someone coming over to Jerusalem and listening to Peter's sermon in Acts 2 during Pentecost and got saved. And they went back home to Rome and they said, I've got to tell others about what I heard down there in Jerusalem when we visited. And this whole church has come about, you know, really by ordinary believers like you and I, not apostles. It's amazing. And it's a very good church. Their testimony's gone out. They're excited about the gospel. They really don't know Paul. And he's writing to them, kind of telling them a little bit about himself now. And he says, since he doesn't really know them, he says, I'm persuaded that you are full of goodness, filled with all knowledge, able also to admonish one another. That's a good assumption based on their report going out to the world of the gospel, right? They've done well. Think about the difference between that statement and what he said to, say, some of his spiritual children in Corinth. What does he say to them? Will it come across very harsh? What about Galatia, the churches of Galatia that he had a hand, a part in starting and winning many of those people to Christ? He says, I marvel that you're so soon removed from the gospel. Who hath bewitched you? And he's talking real strong, like a father to a son, like you would talk to your son going, what are you doing, son? Get on track. This is not what our family does. This is not what I taught you. Listen to how he talks to the Romans, though. I myself am persuaded of you, my brethren. You are full of goodness. He doesn't really know these people. He's not real close to their problems that they're having in church. Undoubtedly, they have problems. He touches on that a little bit in Romans 13 and 14. Some of the schism they may be having between Jew and Gentile. But he's like, hey, you know, you guys are good, I'm sure. Verse 15, nevertheless, brethren, I have written the more boldly unto you in some sort, as putting you in mind. That's almost an understatement, isn't it? Think about what he said to them in chapter 1, 2, and 3. The things he said there, well, if you go out right now and just say them on the street, you could be branded as a hate crime. Like, wow, you are a hater for saying that. You can get in trouble. Now, and I'm sure you could then as well. I'm sure it was like that then. Wow, you're hateful for saying that. Well, it's the truth, so it's actually the most loving thing you can do, is what he said in chapter 1 and 2. But it's very bold. It's very bold in some sort. As putting you in mind, because he's like, why can he do that then? Why can he write the things he's written that are so bold to just strangers? He says, because of the grace that is given to me of God, that I should be the minister of Jesus Christ to the Gentiles, ministering the gospel of God, that the offering up of the Gentiles might be acceptable, being sanctified by the Holy Ghost. What's the word he doesn't use here? Anybody know what he doesn't use here? He used it in chapter 1, right up front in chapter 1. What word is he? What's he talking about here? Anybody think they know? Like, what's the concept he's getting at right here? He's kind of circling around it, I think. Being cordial, being kind. He doesn't come right out with it here, but he did in chapter 1. So I think here he's backing off a little bit. He's like dropping his guard and being, hey, this is just me. He's an apostle, okay? He has major authority over all the churches. He's over their elders in authority. He can tell them what to do. He has written them an inspired letter. This is direct revelation from God flowing through him. But he doesn't say, you know, I'm an apostle. He says, you know, it's because I am a minister of Jesus Christ to the Gentiles. I would say apostle to the Gentiles. So you better listen to him, Rome. But he doesn't use that word. Why? Well, I think he's lowering himself down, saying, I'm just like you guys, honestly, a minister of Jesus Christ to the Gentiles. That's where we all are. And I think there's a reason he's doing that, and we'll get to that. He's appealing to them now for support. He's saying, I'm hoping you guys can help me now on my next missionary journey. I'm hoping you guys can get behind me and support me in my effort to get to Spain. And so he's going to kind of lower himself down, and he's not demanding anything now. Does he have the right to? Yeah, I think so, as an apostle. He's authority. He can say, you need to do this for the sake of the gospel in Spain. But he's like, he's going to leave it up to them. Do you want to partner with me in reaching Spain? So before he gets to that too, he's going to tell a little bit about himself. He says in verse 17, I have therefore whereof I may glory through Jesus Christ in those things which pertain to God. For I will not dare to speak of any of those things which Christ hath not wrought by me, to make the Gentiles obedient by word and deed, through mighty signs and wonders by the power of the Spirit of God, so that from Jerusalem and round about unto Illyricum I have fully preached the gospel of Christ. Yea, so have I strived to preach the gospel, not where Christ was named, lest I should build upon another man's foundation. Let me stop there. What's he saying here? Well, again, I don't think the Romans really know him very well. Most of the Roman believers may have heard of him. They don't know a lot about his ministry. His ministry is not done yet. The book of Acts is not completed. He's still perhaps in Cenchrea, a suburb of Corinth, writing this. He's going to go down to Jerusalem, and that's where he gets arrested, put on the prison ship, and then comes back up by prisoner to Rome, which was not his plan, and crash lands on Malta, gets bit by the viper. Then he gets taken up to Rome. He's put under house arrest, where we presumably believe he remained for a while until he was beheaded by Nero. Okay? None of that's happened yet. So he's just laying out a little, he's going to lay out a little bit of what he wants to do. But he's saying, this is what I have been doing. It's three missionary journeys. He's been doing this circuit from Jerusalem roundabout into Illyricum. Where's Illyricum? Many people say it's maybe where modern Bosnia and Herzegovina is, Albania, even up that far above Greece. And he's kind of done this and come back down and done this and come back down. And he's preaching the gospel there. He's established churches. And he says, hey, I've done my work here. I need to move on into virgin territory where the gospel has not been proclaimed. Where is that? Spain. Okay? He's looking past Rome all the way out to the west in Spain. Many people would say Spain is where Tarshish was. It's the furthest out they could think. Like when Jonah was running from God to Tarshish, he went the opposite direction of Syria and was trying to go all the way out to Spain somewhere, out in the middle of nowhere at that time. The end of the earth, you know. Paul's thinking that way now. He's like, I've done this circuit. I've heard about your faith in Rome. I want to go past you guys and reach the people in Spain, the Spaniards. Now, those are true barbarians, what the Romans and the Athenians would call barbarians. I want to go out there and reach those people for the gospel. And listen to how he describes himself. So when we think about Paul, we think about, wow, what a great example, what a Christian, some people call him the greatest Christian, the greatest missionary. I would say he was the greatest missionary outside of Jesus Christ himself, and a role model and all that. And you know that because you read his writings and you see what he went through. What did he go through? I mean, he got bit by a viper. He got bit by a poisonous snake. You ever been bit by a poisonous snake? And then he lived to tell about it. He talks about how he was floating around in the ocean for days on end. And we know he was whipped and beaten and put in stocks. And at midnight with Silas sang hymns. Did he like curse God and was like, God, why have you done this to me? I'm your missionary. No, he sang hymns of praise to God. God brought a great earthquake. It was a huge revival happened in the jailer's household. Just amazing things like that. Amazing stories that he could have told here. What does he say? He says, he acknowledges, you know, there has been mighty signs and wonders. But why? The power of the Spirit of God working through me. He says, I will not dare speak of any of those things which Christ hath not wrought by me. I'm not going to talk about like what I did in my strength, because that's worthless, he would say. What did Christ do through me? I have strived to preach the gospel, he said. And in a real sense, that's you and I. We work through the power of the Spirit of God. We are not apostles. We are not multi-talented and multi-gifted. Some of us might be more talented than others, but I dare say none of us can match Paul, right? None of us will be able to match Paul in sheer spiritual gifts and magnitude and gospel saturation and all that. He would show us all up, I'm sure. So he's saying, listen, it's just like you. I did this in the power of the Spirit of God. I know you guys started the Roman church in the power of the Spirit of God. I know you guys can reach this area of the world in the power of the Spirit of God right here in New Jersey. You know, you're witnessing, you're preaching the gospel to people around you just like we're going to preach the gospel to people in Bavaria. Nothing special about us. In a way, yeah. I I'm working on it. So that, you know, a little. Definitely working on it, yes. And will continue to work on it for my whole life, probably. So he quotes Isaiah in 21, but as it is written, to whom he was not spoken of, they shall see, and they that have not heard shall understand. I'm going to move on here. Verse 22, for which cause also I've been much hindered from coming to you. He's been so busy in this work, he can't get to Rome. But now having no more place in these parts, what parts? That's the Jerusalem roundabout to Illyricum, Jerusalem up to Athens, something like that. And having a great desire these many years to come unto you, whensoever I take my journey into Spain, I will come to you. For I trust to see you in my journey and to be brought on my way thitherward by you, if first I be somewhat filled with your company. What's he saying? He's saying, I've been hindered from coming to you, but I'm really going for it now. This is the time. I've finished my work here. I got to get to Spain, and I'm going to rendezvous with you on my way to Spain. Rome's a perfect, you know, checkpoint. As he goes, he's going to go to Rome and then go over to Spain. And but what's he going to do in the process? Is he just, you know, I got to get there. Like us, we just get on a plane and go. No, he's going to take his time because he's got some things to accomplish on the way. He's going to be filled with their company. I like that. He wants to build a relationship with the Romans. It's not a, I'm just dropping by and I hope you can just shove some money in my pocket and I'm going to go to Spain after that and live, drive a Ferrari over there while I'm preaching the gospel. You know, he's not a false teacher, okay? False teachers are all about the money. They're like, you know, you're going to get a blessing, just give me money. You'll get a blessing, I promise, just give me money. And there's no relationship, there's no real gospel there. There's no real edification going on, no reciprocity, no mutual edification, no partnership. Just send in some money. We'll send you back some cheap prayer cloth or something that's supposedly going to bless you and get you wealthy. That's not the gospel, and Paul does not do that. Instead, he says, I want to be filled with your company. And he's already said, chapter 1, right? Mutual edification. Why, though, does he want to come? Well, he says, I trust to see you in my journey, verse 24, and to be brought on my way thitherward by you. What's he saying? He's a direct appeal for financial support. Very brief, very subtle, don't miss it. But he's like, hey, I'm hoping you guys can give me some outfit and passage to Spain. And this is, so if you recoil from that and you go, I don't like that. Well, I think this is an integral component to missions, that reciprocity. We can't go everywhere in the world, so how are we going to get this done? How are we going to get the Great Commission done? By sending others who can go, and it takes money to get that done. Okay, money doesn't grow on trees when you surrender to the mission field and surrender to God. It doesn't just send money down from heaven. Where does it come from? It comes through God's people. Ordinary people like you and I just working a job and supporting our missionaries, supporting our pastor so that the gospel can go out. And we see that right here in the first century in the inspired text. So that's comforting to me. What that's saying to me is, hey, what we do here is not man-made. We didn't just make this up, you know, let's send people out and give them money and I hope this is the right way, God. No, it's right here in Romans. The Roman church was, Paul was appealing to the Roman church, a strange church to him, strangers, to support him in his desire to go over and reach the Spaniards. So then you say, hey, that's what we do. We have missionaries in. We try to vote on them. We say, do we have enough in the budget to support them? Let's get them over to Burma. Let's get them over to Australia. Let's get them over to Ireland. These sorts of things to reach people in these different places, just like Paul was doing. Okay, let me skip down to verse 30. This part reads very much like a modern missionary prayer letter now. Verse 30, now I beseech you, brethren, for the Lord Jesus Christ's sake and for the love of the Spirit, that ye strive together with me in your prayers to God for me. That I may be and he lays out the prayer requests. What's he asking for prayer? That I may be delivered from them that do not believe in Judea, and that my service which I have for Jerusalem may be accepted of the saints. He's saying, hey, pray for safety. There's some dangerous parts out there, aren't there? There's many missionaries that are in some dangerous places. Pray for their safety. And that their service may be accepted of the saints, that they can really be successful in their ministry to people. And that I may come unto you with joy by the will of God, and may with you be refreshed, that he can make it back and rendezvous and report on what's going on. Now the God of peace be with you all. Amen. Now we're out of time. I could keep going. And that's why I say this is very much a missionary letter. He's going to go into now chapter 16, verses 1 all the way through 16. People that he does know in Rome now. All this time I've been saying they're strangers. Well, he named like 26 people here he does know to greet. What's going on with that? Well, these are people that he's met in his other three missionary journeys in other places like Ephesus and Macedonia and Galatia and all that. And they have since moved and transferred to Rome. Maybe for jobs, I don't know what. And so he's like, he does know some people there that he's met other places, and he's saying, hey, I want to greet these people. I want to come and see them again. They were my helpers out here in these other parts. And what you start to see then is the supporters. Who was supporting Paul? These people. Aquila and Priscilla, people like that, were behind him the whole way, working alongside him, maybe supporting him in different ways. He mentions Phoebe. He says, she helped me many times. She's apparently a wealthy woman. So when you read those names, you can read those names later on in your own time. You can put yourself into those names. And just imagine one day some of your missionaries would say, yeah, and start mentioning some of you by name and say, it was that person. They helped me. They helped me over here. And that's brilliant, isn't it? And so missions is very partnership-oriented. Again, it's very mutual. Reciprocity is what we try to teach everywhere we go. It's not one way. It's not just you guys pray for us and give us money. It's we mutually edify one another. We're a team, okay? So that's what you are with your missionaries. Let's close in prayer. Father, we thank you so much for your love, your word that you gave to us, your son, that you sent him to die for us, to live for us, and to be resurrected for us. Thank you for that resurrection that we will have one day because we believe on him, for restoring us to fellowship with you, for giving us your word, especially in letters like Romans that teach us so much about the gospel. I pray that you give us grace to be bold in our faith, to be able to share that gospel with those around us, our neighbors, friends, family, co-workers, that they would see Jesus Christ in our lives. Help us, God, to have a mutual relationship with our missionaries, to really reach out to them, strive together to pray for them in their ministries. I pray that we could see fruit from that and even be edified in our own lives from that, and that this church here even would be a great light in this area, that faith would go out in the city, in the state, even in this nation and this world through their missionaries, that people would know, hey, that's a great missions church. That's a great gospel-oriented church, a gospel-preaching church there. And I ask all these things in Jesus' name.